There are plenty of family fun activities that take place over the summer in Southeast Michigan. Some of the more interesting and educational ones occur at Southeast Michigan's Huron-Clinton Metro Parks. In late August, at the Metro Park in Harrison Township, the Lake St. Clair Voyageur Encampment was set up for show and tell and was open for business as an 18th century fur trading post. The Voyageur Encampment represents a wide swatch of French, British, and Native American history in Southeast Michigan. About the time spanning the French and Indian War, which began in 1756, through the Revolutionary War, the War of 1812, and beyond. The camp offers visitors the opportunity to learn about and experience the rich history connected with the early settlers, Native Americans, and soldiers of the Great Lakes fur trade era. Fur trading in North America was so lucrative that France, Britain, and ultimately the United States fought over the lakes, rivers, and land.
This is a reproduction of the firelock that the British Army would carry during the Revolutionary War. The soldiers referred to them affectionately as Brown Bess. They're a 75 caliber barrel, and we would typically use a 69 caliber bullet down there for speed of reloading. And they were the most reliable, fastest reloading infantry weapon of the day, and they still only worked about 75% of the time.
The French and Indian War comprised of the North American theater of the Seven Years' War between Britain and France that lasted until 1763. It pitted the colonies of British America against those of New France.
There's so much that can go wrong. You have to put some powder in the pan and then close your pan. Put the rest of the powder and your bullet and your the paper cartridge down the barrel, ram it down. And then when you fire it, if you're lucky, your piece of flint will strike your piece of steel here and create a shower of sparks. If you're lucky, one of those sparks will land on the powder. If you're lucky, the powder will ignite. And if you're lucky, the fire from the powder igniting in the pan will go through the touch hole and ignite the powder in the barrel, creating a loud boom and sending the bullet toward the enemy. You have to understand that a battle in the 18th century wasn't really, the goal wasn't to kill as many of the enemy as possible, it was to take territory. And the smarter commanders were going to maneuver their troops to be in an advantageous place, not just charge in and try and slaughter a bunch of people, right?
Like chess, in a way.
A much more dangerous game of chess, yes.
Myself, I'm with the 49th Regiment of Foot Grenadier Company, which were, back in the day, was like these elite special forces. We would go in and any dirty work, so to speak, we'd go in and take care of business, so to speak. With our match case here, we'd actually have grenades, and we'd slow burning wick, we'd light them and throw them.
So the grenades were actually around that long ago.
Yeah, but they weren't really refined enough, so they quit using them. Because a lot of times they'd either blow up as you were trying to throw it, or midway, or depending on the wick, the enemy would be able to throw it back at you. Okay. So they dropped the grenades, but they let the grenadiers carry the match cases as insignia of being a grenadier, along with the wings on the coat.
The fur trade was a vital industry in the Great Lakes region long before Michigan became a state. And long before locomotive trains, lakes and rivers made up the highway system used by fur traders in North America. In our region, French-Canadian voyageurs traveled the waterways in birch bark canoes, transporting goods, namely fur, and passengers to and from trading posts. Voyageurs is a French word meaning travelers. It was the voyageurs who were the backbone of the Great Lakes fur trade. To move pelts and supplies, the voyageurs often used large Montreal canoes, which were up to 40 feet in length and carried a crew of 8 to 10 men. The crew was responsible for picking up fur pelts from trading posts and moving them along lakes and rivers to Montreal, where they were shipped back to Europe. Typical voyageurs were not very tall. They were usually under 5 feet 6 inches and weighed less than 150 pounds. But they were strong, which was important, since most of their day was spent paddling the large, heavy canoes. When canoeing, they paddled 40 to 60 strokes a minute, throughout a 12 to 16 hour day. And doing that made for quite an appetite.
Yeah. Pal, 12, 16 hours a day? You better eat a lot of food.
Average man, 9 pounds of food a day. We learned that from the Lewis and Clark expedition. They hired some French voyageurs to help them along the way, huh? They're telling us the 9 pounds of meat we have been giving each man each day is less than they are used to. 9 pounds. That's like 36 quarter pounders of the meat a day, and they complain. That was the meat part of their diet. Yeah. So the bigger the man, the more you must feed.
Fur trade organizations like the Hudson's Bay Company and the American Fur Company employed hundreds of voyageurs. Of course, these companies provided their hungry employees with large amounts of food, but it was the voyageurs who had to carry it, along with the fur pelts, which was what the whole business was about. To help the voyageurs get through the monotony of a long, hard day, they sang songs while they paddled. And when they finally stopped to take a break, they smoked their pipes. The kind of pipe that trader Al Collins might have sold. Al Collins is portraying a French-American Indian trader.
This is a trading blanket right here. As all the stuff that I've made or traded or bought, I normally do not do the tanning and killing. I just trade. I am a middleman. And I also teach primitive arts. Everything that you see here, probably 90% of it is what I've done. I carve Indian effigy pipes. This is a sitting buffalo. I saw in the Time Life series books of a standing buffalo, and actually there's one right up on top, you see that? And so I carved that, was my first pipe that I carved, and then I thought, well, you know, it'd be a whole lot easier if I made a sitting buffalo, and so there it is.
It's very nice.
And I carve it out of all different kinds of pipe stone. The red stone is Catlinite. That's the sacred Indian pipe stone. That's to represent the blood of your ancestors long past. And when you have the pipe ceremony, you put your tobacco in, and you bring the spirits through the pipe and through your ancestors and back to you. It completes the circle of life. And that's what most of the pipes are for, the religious pipes. And these are called great pipes. Not like the smaller pipes, like that one down there, which is a Mi'kmaq style pipe. And French voyageurs had those. And they would carry them around their neck. Mm-hmm. And because they had no pockets in their pants. So they carried everything around their neck. Their beads for trading and the silver and so on. And so whatever they needed, the tobacco, they would come from Detroit and go up to Mackinac, and they would determine how much time it would take to get from here to there, and they would time it on how many times they stopped to smoke their pipe. And so you'd say, well, you're going to Bay City, and they would say that would be five pipes. It's not five times. I mean, you head up to Mackinac, might be 10 or 12 pipes.
The Great Lakes fur trade was a barter system between Europeans and Native Americans. The Europeans offered blankets, guns, hatchets, knives, liquor, and metal cooking pots, while the Native Americans offered pelts. Jerry Smith not only walks the walk of an 18th century fur trader, he talks the talk too, as he showed off his extensive fur collection. Each pelt has its own use, and at one time, the most popular was beaver. A beaver pelt, when treated, made a strong and attractive felt cloth. Beaver hats were so popular that the animal had been hunted into extinction in Europe. Jerry explains how a beaver's diet affects the color of its pelt.
Here you have a nice blonde-looking one. This one is getting a little darker because he's eating deciduous, plus he's eating pine. And this guy is eating nothing but pine, and his fur is almost black. The reason why is pine has tannic acid, and tannic acid makes his fur black. This is a red fox.
That's a nice one.
It's a beautiful pelt. The gentleman who did this passed away, and the interesting part about it is how it's tanned. Most furs are slit. This one is not. It's completely open all the way through, and then he pulls it inside out, tans this portion of it. When he's all done, he pulls it back again, and this is the end product.
Beautiful.
It's a beautiful, beautiful pelt. The possum is a bit of a story in regards to that. About 10 years ago, not much more than that, it started immigrating, started working its way north. And we have possum here, and they're already up into Canada. And they've always been a southern animal. So what causes a migration like that? I don't know, and nobody else does either. Here's one of my favorite pelts. This is coyote. And it's big. The reason why it's big, it was probably raised on a fur farm. They have fur farms in Canada, and they would raise an animal like this. He would eat every day, and so consequently get quite large. Same thing goes for this guy. This is a Arctic fox, and he's big as a wolf. And that's the reason. He was born and bred in a fur farm. Okay, badger has that brown, that white stripe right down the middle of the top of his head. That's a badger. And badgers are in Michigan. They aren't frequently here, but this is gray fox. And here's a pelt that I've had was my first pelt probably 20 years, and it's falling apart. It's a marten. And it's quite a nice animal. Doesn't have a lot of extra color. It looks like he has gray hair in his beard. That little bit of white. Now we're into mink. This is a garage sale mink. It was very common. My mother had one. The ladies all had minks and wanted minks in the 40s and 50s.
For the most part, fur pelts were used for clothing to keep warm and for fashion, which remains a controversial enterprise to this day. Jerry is also an expert on Native American storytelling in the form of pictographs found on the tan side of a pelt.
This particular pictograph is about a gentleman who's has a friend who is dying, and he knows that if he goes off into the woods and finds a certain plant, that he'll be able to save his friend's life. Well, he does that. He goes into the wolf, he has all kinds of adventures, finally finds the plant, rushes back to his friend, and his friend has passed away already. And that's what this is with all. It's telling a story using symbols. And that's what it is.
Oh, yay! Oh, yay!
The Voyageur Encampment is a beehive of activity. Everywhere you look, there's a lifestyle demonstration taking place, like paddle carving, canoe building, woodworking, finger weaving, campfire cooking, muzzle loading, military drills with cannons and other weaponry, and a lot more. There's conversation about history, too. Woodworker Lloyd Baker shared an interesting view of the difference between the Revolutionary War and the American Revolution.
The Revolutionary War and the American Revolution.
It's only
two different things.
Okay.
Even John Adams recognized that and said
yes,
that while
has.
He was president then, and that
so
goes all the way back to, you know, right after George Washington, right? He's the second president. Is that the American Revolution is ongoing, and that is the revolution of a people ruling themselves and defining their own government and molding it and shaping it to do the will of the people, as opposed to the people doing the will of the government. That's the American Revolution.
Mickey Smith, a longtime participant and organizer of the Voyageur Camp, says that the reenactors come from all over Michigan, Ohio, and even Florida. Mickey is also one of the talented performers who demonstrate their craft. She showed those who stopped by everything there is to know about dipping candles, which begins by melting beeswax.
And everybody here kind of developed a skill from the get-go and then decided, I know a lot about this, I'm going to learn even more, and I really like doing it. Like, I've always done candles. My husband always has furs and all the accoutrements that a Voyageur would have. And I have, besides candles, things that I have out, candle holders, and things that I've made and my husband's made, and just lots of interesting things.
Mickey has been dipping candles for camp visitors for more than 20 years, but she and her husband Jerry are also adept at creating other things.
This is, I cut the fur off of about 8 deer legs and then sewed it together with sinew.
And what then, is that used for? It's like a little,
just a little container, yeah. Anything but liquid. You know, seeds, beads, something like that. Then I put a bottom on it. And here's the dew claws of the deer.
That's cool.
So a nice container. Now, this is from a gourd. My husband made this. Very useful. This is from birch bark. I made this one. This is called a macaque. And this is the outside of birch, the birch tree. And you can see the inside. Well, this one, this is the inside. And the outside of the birch tree, of course, has the white. So it's
very nice.
Just a little bit of fanciness.
And these are things that Native Americans would have made?
Yes,
or anybody,
Native Americans or the, you know, Voyageurs.
Yes.
And this is also part of a gourd. I use this to dip water when I need to add water to my candle water.
When it comes to beeswax candle making, Mickey says it's a completely natural process. No colors or dyes are added.
I start out with cotton wicking. Now this is thicker than I usually use, so this, I'm just showing this. And then I put it over a stick. And when I first put it in, it's very difficult because when, if it's windy, it just doesn't want to go in. Now this, as I look over there for a measure, it's probably close to 10 dips. So I would just be careful, let it stop wiggling, dip it, let it air cool. Unless it's a real humid day, then I would dip it in water to cool it down. In between dips, you can almost dip right away, but it's better to just wait 5 seconds. And you get that lemon color, and then as it dries, it gets a little darker.
Now, when you say lemon color, is that just the natural state, or is there ways you can color them?
There are ways to color, but I do never, never, never color wax. What you see is pure 100% beeswax that I had to purchase from a beekeeper. I give him money, he gives me the wax, and then I have to bring it home and chop it up.
Over the years, what began as a gathering of dedicated people interested in history grew to become a multifaceted festival for the senses, complete with reenactments, song and dance, entertainment, colonial games, storytelling, and lectures. Back in the day, an apothecary was, well, a drug dealer. But their intentions were good, and their medicines, however bizarre, were helpful and much sought after.
The year is 1765. And we are in the Great Northwest Territory. That's what they call Michigan, Ohio at this time. And the French have been kicked out. And who's starting to come into this country, into this area? Who just won the French and Indian War?
The British. Mm-hmm.
And there's a British flag right there behind you. And I'm a British surgeon for the Army. And I take good care of the men. Here's some of the medicines I make that actually do work. Now, young lady, you've ever been out in the woods, you get lots of insect bites on you. Here's, and the soldiers come in and they're all covered with insect bites from being out in the woods.
Mosquitoes.
Mm-hmm. And sometimes you get those chiggers that dig under the skin.
Oh, yeah, those are bad.
Yep. That's pig fat and sulfur. No, it sounds kind of yucky, but it takes the itch out, and they actually do work. Soldiers literally will itch themselves to death if they don't get some relief, because itching leads to bleeding, leads to infections, and you sometimes are not strong enough to fight off the infections. They end up dying.
It's no secret the French came for furs, especially beaver pelts used to make felt hats. The French succeeded in their commerce because they adapted and accepted the social customs of native people. And the native people eagerly sought the European trade goods because these items often worked better than what they had, lasted longer, and saved time and labor. Indian villages relied on the new French posts in the region, and they also dealt with independent traders who reached their villages.
I'm with the militia. I'm also Native American, but I'm with the colonial militia, and I'm on a cannon crew.
I'm Larry Mullen, and I'm dressed as a French-Canadian coureur de bois, early 18th century, somewhat Indian-influenced.
Hi, I'm Gary Radu. We're part of the militia. I'm the colonel of the artillery, so we fire the cannon here today.
I'm Uwe Pearl. Today I'm part of the cannon crew. I'm the monkey.
Powder monkey.
And I'm a Potawatomi Indian drafted to the cannon crew.
I'm Ken Roberts. I'm dressed as a French voyageur about 1750, carrying a French Thule trade gun.
If you've never been to a Voyageur camp, the one that comes every summer to the shoreline of Lake St. Clair Metropark is the best. The 13 metroparks in our area cover almost 25,000 acres and serve over 8 million visitors on average annually. To see all the events offered, check for details, dates, and times on the Huron-Clinton Metroparks website at www.metroparks.com. Aside from the cool arts and crafts, demonstrations and music, there's a unique slow-paced calm you get from strolling around the Voyageur encampment. At the camp, there are no electronic devices, no video screens. Just the opportunity to talk to others and take part in the sharing of our unique culture and history. And at the same time, perhaps relearn a lesson. An age-old lesson, really. One we seem to forget at times. That to survive and thrive, we have to rely on each other.